Good evening to all doctors. I would like to thank you all for taking out your precious time from your busy schedule. This webinar is organized by BANAI, Behavioral and Neurosciences Academy of India. BANAI is a not-for-profit organization. It was formed in 2012. BANAI has organized more than 200 programs nationally and internationally. Focus of BANAI is to provide contemporary cutting edge on behavioral neuroscience. BANAI is formed and runs under the guidance and chairmanship of Dr. E. Mohandas.
Good evening to all doctors. I would like to thank you all for taking out your precious time from your busy schedule. This webinar is organized by BANAI.
To introduce Dr. Shobhit Garg as the moderator for today's webinar. Thanks, Dr. Shobhit Garg, for accepting to be the moderator for the webinar. Dr. Shobhit Garg is a consultant psychiatrist at NeuroCare Center, Dehradun, associate professor of psychiatry department, Sri Guru Ram Rai Institute of Medical and Health Sciences, Dehradun. Specialty interests include OCD, schizophrenia, and brain stimulation. Dr. Garg is the Honorary Secretary of the Psychiatric Society Uttarakhand State Branch from 2017 to 2019. I would request Dr. Shobhit Garg to kindly take over and start the session proceedings and introduce the chairpersons. Over to you, Dr. Garg.
Thank you, sir. My kind regards and thanks to my elder senior and mentor, Dr. Venugopal Dhawan, sir. And I would like to invite everyone into this very, very enriching and out-of-the-box session about cognition and apart from dementia. So it's my privilege to invite the two chairpersons for the session. You know, it's an honor. And both the chairpersons, actually, they don't need any introduction as such. First, I would like to invite Dr. Charles Pinto, sir, that he's Professor Emeritus of Psychiatry in the Department of Psychiatry, Topiwala National Medical College and BLYL Nair Hospital. He is Director, Research and Academic and Consultant Psychiatrist at Holy Family Hospital. Dr. Pinto, sir, is a man of the cognition and dementia. He is expertise in geriatric psychiatry. In addition, he has been principal investigator in a lot of drug trials in India, and he has conducted a lot of research work in psychosis, irritable bowel, borderline personality, and the core domain of cognition and dementia, and he has numerous national and international publications. Welcome, sir. Now, coming to the second chairperson, is our very dear senior from our central zone, Dr. Sanjay Gupta, sir, and he's a man of, I would say, positive cognition. There is no negative bone or negative cognition in sir, and we were privileged to hear him few days before, but he's been a professor in psychiatry in prestigious Institute of Medical Science, Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi, and he's also head of the Stress Management Counseling Center, Banaras Hindu University, sir has immense 3 decades of teaching experience in a central institute, and his areas of specialization, as we know, is stress management and positive psych. Sir has held a lot of prestigious positions in IPS, IABMH, and IMA. To name a few. Welcome, sir, to the session. And sir, I would request for the chairperson to kindly comment this interesting session. Thank you, sir.
So should I start?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So Dr. Shobhit Garg, thank you for the introduction. And I thank Dr. Venu and BANAI for throwing a googly and calling me for a talk to participate in a seminar on non-dementia cognitive deficits in psychiatric disorders. I think it all started with Emil Kraepelin years ago when he first defined dementia praecox, and which went ahead straight later on to Alois Alzheimer, who described psychiatric symptoms, which also occur in dementia. These particular defects or deficits in cognitive function vary from a decreased attention, working memory issues, disrupted social cognition, and language impairment, which are common to all psychiatric disorders, in a review from Milan et al. They severely compromise the quality of life, and their causes vary from interactive effects of genetic, epigenetic, developmental and environmental, disrupting cellular and cerebral networks involved in integrating and modulating cognition. There are several pharmacological strategies. Three have been described for ADHD, schizophrenia, and depression, and they vary from the standard drugs for the treatment of all these three conditions, but also include stimulants, antidepressants, anti-dementia drugs, cycloserine, amphokines, 7-alpha-7 nicotinic receptors, block agonists, and the new one, vortioxetine. Also, there are relevance of non-pharmacological interventions like cognitive remediating, retraining, learning machines, which may also help. Today, to understand this and see the evidence-based effectivity of understanding, analyzing, measuring, modifying by drug and other therapies is the feature of this presentation, Evidence-Based Management of Cognitive Deficits in Psychiatric Disorders Other Than Dementia by Dr. Naren Rao, who is the Associate Professor, Department of Psychiatry in NIMHANS. So I invite Dr. Naren Rao to be introduced and to be start the topic.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Charles Pinto, for introducing the topic. Good evening to all. To this evidence-based management of cognitive deficits in psychiatric disorders other than dementia. Thank you very much, Dr. Shobhit Garg, very, very dear colleague of mine, for his very cordial welcome and notes of kindness. Thank you to Benai and to Dr. Venu Gopal Jhawar for inviting me as a chairperson in his web series that he's continuing in a very effective way. Today, I think it's going to be a very marvelous evening in which we're going to talk about cognition. And whenever we talk about cognition, cognition is a very, very intricate subject. It needs a high degree of specialization. And I'd like to just share with all of you that today the speaker is an expert, a pure expert on the topic. I'd like to welcome Dr. Naren Rao. He's an MD. He's an associate professor at NIMHANS Bangalore. He has an international postdoctoral fellowship in psychiatric neuroimaging and several international awards to his credit. Research interests include neurobiology of schizophrenia, OCD, PET, magnetic resonance imaging, neurocognition, and assessment. He's been honored with numerous awards. I think if we go into the awards list, we won't be finishing the whole evening. We won't have his lecture. This includes the DBT Innovative Young Biotechnologist, the Canada Hope Scholarship. Dr. Naren Rao, it's a pleasure to welcome you. And I think everybody's going to be very, very illuminated after your marvelous talk. Over to Dr. Naren Rao. But before that, I'd just like to share with all of you that your questions are very, very important. And to add to the questions, for a best question, yes, questions can also be, everybody has a good question, but we're going to announce a best question That best question is going to win you a 5,000 rupee Amazon e-voucher. And that will be announced that who has posted the best question at the end of the program today. So keep your questions coming. I'm quite sure the speaker will be very happy to answer it. And all the best for the best question. Thank you, Dr. Naren Rao. Over to you. We welcome you to this evening program. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta, for the kind introduction. At the outset, I thank Dr. Venugopal Jhawar and Banai for the invitation. And I thank Dr. Charles Pinto for the kind introduction to the topic and making my job easier because sir has already given a summary of what I'm going to speak. Thank you, sir. So the topic given to me today is evidence-based management of cognitive deficits in psychiatric disorders other than dementia. So in the next 45 to 50 minutes, I will try to do justice to the topic and I'll be happy to take up any questions at the end of the topic. So this will be the outline of my presentation. So where do you see, that is in which all disorders you see cognitive deficits? Why should we treat? How is it going to make an impact in patients' life? How common is it? Is it something that I need to be looking in each and every person, or is it something which is rare? And if I have to look, how do I assess that? And then if I assess that and then I know that there is a deficit, how do we treat it? So before we go to the evidence base, that is the last part of my talk, maybe in the initial 5 to 10 minutes, I will just give a brief, which will make the evidence base to be analyzed in a scientific manner. So cognitive deficits in psychiatric disorders are seen in several conditions. For that matter, it is seen in most of the conditions. Because cognitive functions are the core features of the brain, it is not surprising that psychiatric disorders, whichever is influenced by this neuropathology, are considerably involve cognitive dysfunction. So most of the psychiatric conditions do have one or the other kind of cognitive deficit, but the therapeutic trials have mainly focused on schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, and major depressive disorder. Because today's topic is on evidence-based management, so I thought I will restrict to these three in the given time, because the topic is vast, and if I go to the other disorders, like the child psychiatric disorders, the time may not be sufficient. So I'll be restricting mainly to the adult psychiatry, and because the intervention is mainly focused on these disorders, so I'll be focusing my talk on schizophrenia, bipolar, and major depressive disorder. So like I was mentioning, it's not surprising that cognitive dysfunctions are seen in other disorders also, other than these three which I mentioned. For example, we ourselves have seen cognitive deficits in OCD. There are a good literature in PTSD, other anxiety disorders, panic disorder. So it's not surprising that cognitive deficits are seen in all disorders, but because of the therapeutic trials availability, I will be focusing mainly on schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, and major depressive disorder. So why should we treat? So the dysfunction in cognition and social cognition has a significant impact on patients' functional status. So schizophrenia patients, for example, have poorer community functioning, and then this poorer community functioning, which is involving the independence in daily living or the community involvement, is significantly determined by the cognitive deficits. So more than the positive symptoms, it's the negative and the cognitive symptoms which actually determine the functional status or the functional recovery of the patient with schizophrenia. So if we are aiming for recovery and not just symptom remission, we need to address the impaired cognition and social cognition in all patients with major psychosis. So how common it is? So there are several studies which have looked into the prevalence of cognitive deficits. So when I speak of prevalence of cognitive deficits, it's the significant cognitive deficit which can result in dysfunction. So schizophrenia, it is generic and diffuse. So it is seen in most of the patients and it involves multiple cognitive domains. So 3 out of 4 patients have impairment in schizophrenia, according to several meta-analyses and well-conducted studies. So an emerging evidence also suggests that bipolar disorder is also associated with cognitive dysfunction in a majority of the patients, that is as much as in schizophrenia. The only difference between bipolar disorder and schizophrenia is that the severity of the cognitive deficit is much more in schizophrenia compared to bipolar disorder, at least in the initial part of the illness. Major depressive disorder, earlier it was thought that cognitive deficits are an epiphenomena of the depressed mood, and once you treat the depressed mood, rest of the cognitive dysfunction will disappear by on its own. But several studies are now suggesting that 25 to 50% of patients with major depressive disorder exhibit one or the other cognitive deficit as a trait marker. That is, even after they have improved in their depressed mood, they may continue to exhibit cognitive deficit. So just to give you an example, I thought I would pull out one of the cases that I saw yesterday. Mr. X is a 24-year-old male, single, completed MBBS recently and preparing for PG exams. So he has history of schizophrenia for 4 years and treatment with olanzapine 25 mg per day and under remission for the past 18 months. So now the concern of Mr. X is not delusions or the hallucinations, even for the family, but that he has been preparing for PG exams, but complains that he has a lot of difficulty in preparing for exams. He cannot remember the names of the drugs, not able to concentrate while reading, have to read same chapter many times, and he's afraid that he will not be able to get a postgraduate seat. So this is one of the common scenario that you come across in any patient with a major psychiatric disorder, that with time, once you achieve symptom remission, the focus shifts to the functional recovery, and that is where the cognitive deficits come into the picture. So how do we assess? So there are both structured and unstructured ways of assessing cognitive deficits. I will be speaking mainly on the structured assessments here. We have learned practitioners who can throw light on the practical tips. I will also be happy to address if there are any questions on how to assess cognitive dysfunction on a day-to-day clinical practice at a later stage. Mainly, if we have to go with a structured assessment in evidence-based, because the topic is evidence-based, I thought I will touch upon some of the structured assessments. So there are screening instruments which have been borrowed from the dementia literature, the Mini-Mental Status Examination or the Hindi-Mental Status Examination or Montreal Cognitive Assessment. Then there are structured tests which are individual tests like NBAC, Ray Auditory Learning Test, or complex figure test for the visual spatial functioning or the emotion recognition task. So in addition to these individual tests, what the field has moved on now is to look at cognition as a composite score. So by way of a neuropsychological battery. So one of the commonly used battery in most of the drug trials is the Matrix Consensus Cognitive Battery. And this is available for both schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. And this measures 7 domains of cognition, which are very commonly involved in schizophrenia and bipolar. So it's the speed of processing, attention, working memory, visual learning, social cognition, reasoning, problem solving, and verbal learning. There are also other batteries like Cogstate, brief assessment of cognition in schizophrenia. So if somebody wants to use it in their routine day-to-day clinic also, so maybe the BACS is a brief, which takes around 30 minutes of time. So these are more structured. Structured assessments primarily to assess if you're looking for an evidence base or if you want to document the improvement, but you can definitely assess the cognitive functions by a clinical interview as good as these instruments. So what's the biology of cognitive deficits? While we know considerably about the biology of the positive symptoms, the biology of cognitive deficit is not completely understood in several psychiatric disorders. So one of the important findings is that it is the decreased dopamine release in cortical areas, which is associated with neurocognitive deficit. Please note that it is decreased and not increased dopamine. because increased dopamine is associated with positive symptoms in the subcortical regions, whereas it is the decreased dopamine in the cortical areas which is associated in, with cognitive deficits. So this becomes very important when we go to the management. So there is also an emerging evidence which suggests that there is a very significant role of neuropeptides, oxytocin and vasopressin in social cognition. There is definitely possibility of other neurotransmitters like acetylcholine, which is mainly implicated in dementia. But it also plays a considerable role in other psychiatric disorders and serotonin, glutamate, GABA, and multiple other neurotransmitters. So it's not a single neurotransmitter which is important, but it is the balance between the multiple neurotransmitters. So there is enough literature now to suggest, using the positron emission studies also, that it is the decreased release of dopamine in the prefrontal cortex, at least in schizophrenia, which is associated with considerable cognitive deficits. So now that we know the importance of cognitive deficits and we know how to assess, or at least what are all the instruments that are used to assess the cognitive deficits, so how do we treat these cognitive deficits? So I'll take one after the other, starting from schizophrenia, because the major emphasis in the scientific literature has been on schizophrenia with respect to cognition. Like Dr. Pinto mentioned, historically also schizophrenia was considered as a dementia precog. So cognitive deficits are well recognized in both patients as well as in their first degree relatives and people who are at high risk of developing schizophrenia. So before we go to individual drugs or the individual group of drugs, I thought I will just touch upon the level of evidence for therapeutic studies. This is from the Oxford group. So the systematic review or the meta-analysis of RCTs always takes the highest level of evidence, followed by individual RCTs, and then comes low-quality RCTs or the open-label studies, and finally the case series or the case reports. And when you don't have any of the empirical evidence, that is where the level 5 is the expert opinion without critical appraisal of the empirical data. So I will be focusing wherever it is available, I will be focusing on the meta-analysis. And when there is no meta-analysis for a specific question, I will be going to the individual RCTs. And if we don't have individual RCTs, that is when I will go to the case control or the open label studies. So the first question which comes to everybody's mind is, if cognitive dysfunction is seen in each and every patient, or at least 3 out of 4 patients with schizophrenia, then why not we address it from the beginning? So which antipsychotic is better if we think that the cognitive dysfunction is present right from the beginning? So there is very little to choose among the antipsychotics, because the difference between the antipsychotics is not considerably high when it comes to atypical antipsychotic. So between the typical and the atypical antipsychotic, there is definite edge for the atypical antipsychotic. Not that the typical antipsychotics are bad, because even typical antipsychotics as a mixed bag, they improve in cognitive functions with an effect size of around 0.22. But among the atypical antipsychotics, some studies suggest that olanzapine and risperidone are better than amisulpride for global cognition. Ziprasidone had better effect on memory, and quetiapine was better for processing speed, executive functions, and attention. But please remember, these are all individual studies. So the meta-analysis is primarily as a group and not for individual studies. So in the beginning, when you have flow rate positive symptoms and predominant negative symptoms, it may be a good idea to first address them, because many times, similar to the secondary negative symptoms, you may also see secondary cognitive symptoms. So once you address these positive symptoms, for example, with the typical antipsychotic, there is an improvement in cognitive functions. But when you continue for the maintenance phase, that is when the choice of antipsychotics comes into the picture. Because typical antipsychotics are known to worsen cognitive functions when it comes to the maintenance phase. So I mentioned the term of effect size. This is something which we'll figure out repeatedly in my presentation, because the evidence base, I feel it is more important to know the clinical relevance, that is the effect size, rather than the statistical significance. Because when we read a paper, we are always chasing behind the p-value of 0.05 to see whether it's significant or not. But for a practicing clinician, the statistical significance may not make much sense without effect size. So if you look at statistical significance, it primarily tells what is the probability that a difference between the drug and the placebo is by chance. Okay, so that is, it answers the question, does the drug work better than placebo or not? But for a practicing clinician, that is not sufficient, because we also want to know, okay, if it is going to be better than placebo, how much better it is compared to placebo? Is it like 30% improvement? Is it like 40% improvement? What do we see? Okay, so that is where the effect size comes into the picture. So any effect size which is less than 0.2 is considered very small. Something which is between 0.2 to 0.4 is small. So around 0.5 is medium effect size, and then 0.8 to 1.2 is the large and the very large effect size. So something which is of 2 effect size is a huge effect size. So clinically it becomes important if the effect size is 0.5 and above. So among the antipsychotic, one drug which has shown to be better than multiple other medications is lurasidone. So we don't have a meta-analysis for this, but there are two RCTs which are showing a beneficial effect. It's important to note that the higher dose of lurasidone is far better compared to the lower dose of lurasidone in these RCTs. And it was also confirmed in a follow-up at 6 months. So not only in the short term, but also at the 6 months interval, 160 mg of lurasidone was better than placebo as well as quetiapine, but not 80 mg of lurasidone. So if you're targeting lurasidone, schizophrenia with lurasidone, you need to go for a higher dose of the antipsychotic. So there are multiple reasons which are proposed for that. It could be because of the serotonergic activity and the absence of the effect at D4 receptors, but those are primarily for the academic interest. So clinically, what is important is, among the antipsychotic medication, comparatively, go for a drug which is less sedative, which is having less CPS. So these two characteristics will help you to determine whether a drug is going to be beneficial in cognition or not. The only exception is amisulpride. Somehow the amisulpride, we don't have much evidence because people haven't examined it much, but with the available evidence, it looks like amisulpride may not have an edge for cognitive dysfunction, whereas it has a definite edge for the negative symptoms. So before we dwell into individual drugs, other than the antipsychotic, I thought I will just touch upon why we see some things which are very, very different when we read a paper. So we do see some of the studies which report big effect size, but people don't take it seriously because the sample size is small. Okay. So you can get a significance, that is statistical significance, if you have big effect size with small sample size, or if you have big sample with small effect size. But both of them are not clinically meaningful, because with a small sample size, you don't have a representative population, so it cannot generalize the findings of that particular study. Whereas in case of big sample with a small effect size, it is not clinically meaningful because it is just an academic activity of finding a statistical significance. So what we need is a big sample with big effect size for a clinical purpose, but unfortunately, because it involves so much of money, individual studies, it is difficult to find. So that is where the meta-analysis will come into the picture. Okay. So there is only one RCT for cognition in treatment-resistant schizophrenia, which drug is helpful. So in this, the authors used 240 milligram of lurasidone, and this was better than 80 milligram of lurasidone. So as you could see in the right side of your screen, the effect size was reasonably better. So it was a medium effect size with 0.4 to 0.5, and the improvement was mainly seen in attention and reasoning. So you also see a similar picture with clozapine when you give clozapine and measure the cognitive functions. So one other strategy which can come into the picture, and it is very, very useful, is first you assess whether somebody needs the same dose of antipsychotic that they were taking in the acute phase. Because I mentioned it is not the increased dopamine, but the decreased dopamine. So if you are flooding the dopamine receptors with the antipsychotic medication, you are actually blocking all the available receptors. So many times it is the reduction of the dose rather than the increase in the dose, which is shown to be beneficial. Okay. So if you decrease the dose of the antipsychotic to an extent of minimal effective dose, there are 3 RCTs and 1 systematic review. All have reported a medium to large effect size of around 0.7. So when I say minimal effective dose, it's around 10 milligram of olanzapine, equivalent of a drug. So the improvement was mainly seen in executive functions and memory. So it's not the processing speed. So that's why we could be assured that it is not just because of the reduction in the EPS. So it is independent of the EPS. If you decrease the dose, you will see a beneficial effect in cognition. So we recently also have completed this study. So Dr. Animisha, who was my MD student, did this in her MD thesis. And we saw that the reduction in antipsychotic dose was associated with improvement in BACS composite score. So if the dose of the antipsychotic is reduced to around 10 milligram of olanzapine equivalent, it was associated with better improvement, as you could see in the right side of the screen. So it's the y-axis is the BACS total score. So whenever the dose was decreased, in most of the patients, you could see that there was an upward trend in the BACS total score. So the second strategy, other than meddling with the antipsychotic, is if the patient is an anticholinergic, discontinue the anticholinergic. And it goes with the discontinuation of benzodiazepine also. So this is something which everybody knows because practice-wise, everybody is aware that anticholinergics cause cognitive dysfunction. However, there is not much scientific literature because none of these medications are new. So we have this scientific literature only recently examining it in a systematic way. There's only one open label study and it showed there was a significant improvement in the cognitive functions when you discontinue triexifinidil. And there was no worsening in EPS. So the first strategy could be assess whether somebody requires this much antipsychotic, and the second strategy could be discontinue all unwanted, unnecessary medications, whether they are actually causing cognitive dysfunction. So one group of medication which is very commonly prescribed whenever somebody has negative symptoms or cognitive dysfunction is antidepressant. So people have used, and in some instances we do see an improvement when we prescribe antidepressant. But many times it could be because of a secondary cognitive dysfunction similar to the secondary negative symptom. So in the absence of syndromal depression, if you're prescribing antidepressant, studies suggest that the effect that you get is clinically negligible. That is, with an effect size of 0.1 to 0.2, you actually don't make a meaningful change in the patient's community functioning or in their ability to stick on to their work. So several antidepressants have been examined in schizophrenia and none of them have shown to be very useful across the different antidepressant classes. So as you could see in the right side of the screen, there is not much improvement in terms of the effect size, but it was statistically significant. So because they are harmless, and if you're suspecting that the patient may have depressive symptoms, it's worth giving. But if there is no depressive symptoms, then adding antidepressant may not be helpful. Anti-dementia drug. Okay. So this is again one class of medication which has been extensively examined in schizophrenia and still continues to be used widely, primarily with the belief that if the medication can work in one kind of disease, whether the same thing can work in the other, because the cognitive dysfunction may have the same neurobiology. Okay. So the difference between the dementia and the major psychosis like schizophrenia and bipolar is you are dealing with one neurodevelopmental, that is schizophrenia and bipolar, whereas you are dealing with a neurodegenerative condition. So several anti-dementia drugs have been examined, and there is a good meta-analysis which looked 37 studies with 1,574, and the improvement was seen only in mini mental status examination. So the improvement in MMSE rarely translates to a real life improvement. That's why the authors suggested that there was no difference in any other cognitive function. Even statistical significance was seen only with one domain, that is verbal learning score, whereas in all other domains, there was no statistical significance. So MMSE could be influenced by several factors. That's why I think it is safer to assume that anti-dementia drugs need not be the first line of medication for cognitive dysfunction in non-dementia psychiatric disorders. So other than the pharmacological management, an emerging evidence suggests that an aerobic exercise may have as much as a medication or sometimes even better than the medication, even in psychiatric conditions. So this is a meta-analysis of 10 studies, but you can note down, you can notice that the number is small because this sample size is very small here. So there was an improvement in global cognition as well as individual cognitive domain. And interestingly, there was also a dose response relationship, that is greater the amount of exercise, better the cognition, and supervised exercise gave better cognitive function. So this suggests that non-pharmacological interventions like aerobic exercise, which has definite metabolic advantage, could also result in improvement in cognitive functions. But if you notice the sample size of this meta-analysis versus the pharmacological meta-analysis, you cannot compare this sample size. So we definitely need bigger studies to definitely address the question whether the aerobic exercise is sufficient. But because it is not associated with serious side effects, it may be a first step in most of the patients with schizophrenia, that you could give them an advice on the exercise, which could result in improvement in both cognition as well as several metabolic parameters. So this is the forest plot of the same meta-analysis which I mentioned. So as you could see, there was a good variation, but put together there was a medium effect size of around 0.4 for the global cognition. So one strategy which has consistently shown to be beneficial in schizophrenia is cognitive remediation. So it could be a cognitive retraining or it could be a cognitive restoration. This is a meta-analysis of 37 studies with 2,100 participants. There was an improvement in global measure as well as individual cognitive domains. The major limitation of cognitive remediation studies is the small sample size in individual studies because of the time intensity. But at the same time, most of the studies consistently report an improvement with the cognitive remediation. So the main drawback is the cost, because you need to have several sessions, sometimes 20 to 30 sessions, to see any change in the patient. So the cost effectiveness of this is less, and also the availability of a trained person to do the cognitive retraining, because you need a detailed assessment as well as later the cognitive retraining. So people have looked whether computerized cognitive retraining can replace the manual cognitive retraining. So this was a meta-analysis. This showed that it still produces small to medium effect size, but it is not as good as a therapist-administered cognitive retraining. So in resource-constrained areas, this may be one of the option to begin with because of the safety and there is no side effect, and people can use this computerized cognitive retraining, but again, they are not free. So if a person can afford, there are several packages which are available, and maybe the initial manual therapist administered followed by a computerized cognitive retraining is something that is feasible. So one drug which has come up repeatedly for the treatment of social cognitive deficits is oxytocin. This is primarily based on the literature that in healthy individuals, oxytocin produced remarkable change in social cognition. However, when it was tried in patients with schizophrenia, several studies have reported beneficial, but at the same time, there are several studies which have reported negative findings. So a meta-analysis actually showed that there is no significant effect on basic social cognitive functions like emotion recognition or empathy, but there could be an added edge for the higher order social cognitive functions like trust or the theory of mind deficits. So in selected patients, oxytocin intranasally, not intravenously, may have some role, but at this stage the evidence is very poor and it is still a research question and hasn't resulted in a translational clinical application yet. So the Indian counterpart of the aerobic exercise, yoga, there are few studies, one RCT and one open label trial in social cognition. They both reported improvement in social cognition after 15 to 20 sessions. There are two studies of RCT of yoga versus treatment as usual and yoga versus supervised exercise for neurocognition. From the Delhi, Dr. Smita Deshpande and her colleagues. There was a greater improvement in attention and the males had better improvement than women in those studies. And interestingly, it was also replicated in a different study sample. And the effect size in this is big, but as I mentioned, small sample sizes always gives you bigger effect size. So we need to take it with caution and should not go only with the effect size. So some honorable mentions, because these are the molecules which repeatedly time and again comes because of the novelty factor. Whenever a new molecule which may be useful in other illness comes into the market, people try it. Varenicline is one such molecule, but four studies showed that it is not better than placebo. Modafinil and stimulants again were tried. There are 11 studies with 422 patients. This is a meta-analysis. No clear benefit compared to placebo in cognitive functions. Lisdex amphetamine, which is used in ADHD, there is only one RCT which reported positive effect, but the effect size was not very great. A word of caution with both modafinil and Lisdex amphetamine is that theoretically they carry the risk of worsening of positive symptoms. But in both the meta-analysis of varenicline and modafinil, there was no worsening of positive symptoms with both these medications. So we have to take a decision on an individual case-by-case basis whether you are ready to give stimulant. But if you give a stimulant under the cover of an atypical antipsychotic, the chances of worsening of mood, psychotic symptoms may be very less. So some of the other molecules which have been tried, cannabidiol, there is no effect. There is only one RCT recently. Relaxifen is one molecule, which is a phytoestrogen. It was better than placebo in postmenopausal women. Again, only one RCT, so the level of evidence is less, but maybe in selected group of patients, relaxifen may be one of the choice. Recently, people have started looking into training for the social cognitive deficits. Social Ville is one such app which people have used, and systematic studies have shown that by using a mobile app, you could get some improvement in social cognition. Again, small sample size, but it's a very interesting proposal. Another area which is upcoming is the virtual reality, and it could be used for improvement in social skill training as well as social cognition. And few studies have shown that this may actually translate to a real life benefit. So just to give a summary of schizophrenia evidence base, antipsychotic dose reduction, there is a medium effect. There are independent RCTs for that. Choice of antipsychotic, medium effect, but there is only one RCT and it suggests lurasidone may have an edge compared to quetiapine and other antipsychotics. Antidepressants, though statistically significant, clinically negligible. Aerobic exercise, small to medium. Anti-dementia drugs, more or less not much helpful in schizophrenia. Cognitive remediation, medium effect size. So at present that has the best evidence, but at the same time, the sample size is not very big. Computerized cognitive remediation, again, small to medium effect size. Oxytocin, small. Yoga, medium, but the level of evidence is low. Varenicline and modafinil, again, it is negative. So this is the summary of schizophrenia evidence base. From schizophrenia, let us move on to bipolar disorder. I will briefly touch upon the available studies, but we don't have many studies like in schizophrenia, so I will be discussing whatever the evidence and the scientific literature that is available with us. So similar to schizophrenia, neurocognitive impairments affect social functioning, quality of life, and employment outcome even in bipolar disorder. And interestingly, you do see several patients with bipolar disorder who may be very good in the beginning, but with progressive worsening of the illness, they may develop cognitive deficits. So one-time assessment is not sufficient. You may have to repeat the assessments in bipolar disorder because it may be accumulative, at least in the initial part of the illness. So choice of mood stabilizer. So traditionally, people have associated lithium with the worsening of creativity and worsening of cognitive functions. But the scientific evidence is equivocal. In the short term, some studies suggest that there may be worsening of cognitive functions with lithium, but there are other studies which report that there is no worsening. There's one meta-analysis which suggests that there may be a worsening of cognitive functions in the short term, but in the long term, there is no effect on cognitive functions. At least two naturalistic studies have shown that. Lamotrigine may be better than valproate or carbamazepine in a 6-month follow-up study. So this is the only study which is available. And improvement was mainly seen in verbal fluency and verbal memory. We don't have controlled studies for valproate or carbamazepine, but borrowing from the literature of epilepsy patients, these drugs are known to cause psychomotor retardation and impairment in memory and attention. So among the mood stabilizer, maybe lamotrigine is a first choice, and then comes the lithium, and then comes rest of the anticonvulsants with respect to cognition. Choice of antipsychotic, people have examined quetiapine versus other antipsychotics because quetiapine is one of the mainstream medication for bipolar now. Studies are equivocal. One RCT suggested quetiapine is better, the other suggested risperidone is better. Again, lurasidone, borrowing from the schizophrenia literature, people have examined lurasidone. There is only one RCT with a small sample, but that RCT suggested a large effect size on cognitive functions up to 0.8. And lurasidone add-on was better than treatment as usual. So you need to note that it is not placebo, so there could be some amount of expectancy bias with this trial, but this is one of the neatly conducted trial which suggests that lurasidone may have an edge with respect to any atypical antipsychotic when it comes to cognition. People have examined, again, anti-dementia drug, acetylcholinesterase inhibitors. A meta-analysis of 12 studies suggested no benefit on cognition in bipolar disorder. So somehow the drugs which result in beneficial effect in dementia fail to show a similar benefit in both bipolar and schizophrenia. So across molecules, it's the negative finding. So some of the emerging treatments, people have started looking into new molecules. Mifepristone is one such molecule. It's a corticosteroid antagonist. So two RCTs have reported improvement in working memory, but again, small sample size. So we need a few more studies before translating to clinic. Pramipexole is a dopaminergic agent. There was an improvement in processing speed and working memory, but only one study. So one of the Ayurvedic preparation is ashwagandha. One RCT has examined use of ashwagandha in bipolar disorder and suggested there was a better performance in verbal working memory. And this was published in Journal of Clinical Psychiatry in 2013. So erythropoietin, again, only one study suggested improvement but never replicated. So without replication, it is too early to think whether any of these molecules will stand the test of time. People have also been examining multiple other molecules like N-acetylcysteine, omega-3 polyunsaturated fatty acids, but we don't have much studies with these molecules. So an individual practitioner has to make a decision based on very little evidence if you have to give any of these molecules. But because of the safety profile, many of these molecules have been widely used. But the effect sizes when you see also in clinical practice are not very great. Major depressive disorders, initially it was thought that cognitive dysfunction is an epiphenomena, that is people improve in cognition as and when they improve in the mood. And also people thought that it is not an objective deficit, but because of the low self-confidence, people may report that they can't remember. So, but studies have suggested that it is not only subjective, but also objective deficit. And interestingly, this one study suggested that the cognitive functions accounted for better work performance than the HAM-D score, as you could see in the right side of your screen. So the variability explained by the cognitive function was far higher compared to the variability explained by the HAM-D score. with respect to the work performance. So in a selected group of population, maybe around 1/4 to half of the population with depression, there may be a real cognitive deficit. Whether these people are undiagnosed bipolar is a big question that we will need to analyze. But at present, there are definite studies which suggest that cognitive dysfunction is one of the major problem in depression also. So this is the summary of the available evidence with respect to the antidepressants and the other molecules. So all the pharmacological treatments for cognition in major depressive disorder are summarized in this. So as you could see, ortiaxetine has the highest level of evidence across cognitive domains. The next comes duloxetine in certain cognitive functions, mainly in learning and memory. Whereas the modafinil, which is commonly prescribed, doesn't have much evidence base. Let's take amphetamine. Again, there is only one RCT which suggests that there may be a beneficial effect. Okay. So while I say that there is no evidence, absence of evidence doesn't mean evidence to the contrary. So it's just that it has not been examined in systematic way. So there is no reason to believe that these things do not work. It is just that we don't have sufficient evidence that these things work. I think it's very important to make that distinction before deciding whether you want to give a molecule or not. So the last part is what to do when somebody has an ECT-related cognitive deficit. So this is one area in which, again, the anti-dementia drugs comes into the picture, because people have tried multiple medications, memantine, rivastigmine, donepezil, and galantamine, and somehow it looks like the anti-dementia drugs, when they fail to give effect in schizophrenia or bipolar per se, actually results in better improvement in ECT-related cognitive deficit. And especially this was used as a cognitive enhancer prophylaxis. So it is not treatment of the deficit after the onset, but it is mainly the prophylaxis. So maybe you could give the day before ECT and then continue till the end of the ECT. With the cognitive enhancer prophylaxis. One other thing which has been shown in many studies is that if you could decrease the hypoxia and the seizure duration and the post-ECT delirium, the cognitive deficits may come down. So the anti-dementia drugs definitely have a role to play in ECT-related cognitive deficits. So I thought I will give some clinical case vignettes. Unfortunately, I don't think we'll be able to make it like an interactive one. I doubt whether it is possible in this platform. But nonetheless, if we have to choose the medications for this, we could decide on different case scenarios. Can I go through the case scenarios? I request the chairpersons to permit, or am I already overshooting on the time? Sir, can I go ahead?
No. Dr. Shobhit, what do you think?
Because if yes, sir. I think, sir, we can take, sir, at least how many cases you have, sir?
No, I had some 4 cases, but now that we can't do interactive, maybe we can take up the questions, and I could allude to the cases as the questions come.
Okay. If the chairperson's permit, so then we can go ahead with the questions, or sir, shall we take the case with next? This is discretion of the chairperson.
How much time we have,
sir? We
for discussion.
Chip in for 40 minutes. The presentation. I think, sir, we have exceeded the time for 40 minutes.
Exceeded the time. Okay.
Yes.
Then I think so. We can take the question then.
Yeah.
Are there interesting cases?
It was just primarily a discussion point. Maybe I will just
okay.
Yes, sir. Sir, just you can brush through, sir. I think
I can brush through, no problem, because he has prepared it.
I think Dr. Rao, I think in the course of the questions, your case vignettes would be and the points that you want to cut across, I think they would come in. Okay. So because we've already exceeded the time.
Yeah, I think summarize and end it.
Yeah, you're the expert, so you can take it up in the questions, right?
Sure.
Thank you. And you can summarize, please. Thank you.
Yeah. So to summarize, cognitive deficits are frequently seen in several psychiatric disorders, and cognitive deficits are determinants of functional outcome. There is modest effect of core treatment. So I mean, when I mean core treatment, it is the antipsychotic or the antidepressant per se. So there is a requirement of add-on therapy with specific molecules in many instances. Unfortunately, there is no absent or minimal efficacy of anti-dementia drugs in these psychiatric disorders. And several pharmacological treatments have been tried, but they are with small effect sizes. At present, non-pharmacological have greater effect size, but they are plagued by the problem of small sample size. So we definitely need new strategies and a mix and match of these available options to address the problem of cognitive deficits. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Narendra, for a brilliant and a very exhaustive, deeply analyzed presentation. I'm sure it has thrown up a lot of questions to the audience. I'm sure they're going to have a lot of questions to you.
Sure.
So we'll take up the questions, I think. So, yeah.
Sure.
Dr. Shobhit?
Yes, sir. So, congratulations, Dr. Naren, for giving a very crisp and summarized presentation. So, there have been, you know, there have been, I think, a lot of questions, and I think I can see a lot of excitement among the audience. And I will put the questions series wise. I have selected those questions. So, first question is by Rudra Raju. That are cognitive deficits state markers or trait markers? I think your opening slide had just briefed upon it. But can you elaborate, sir?
Sure. So most of the cognitive deficits are trait markers. So what I mean by trait markers is even after the remission of the psychotic or the mood symptoms, you still see these cognitive deficits. So cognitive deficits are seen in remitted schizophrenia, euthymic bipolar, and remitted depressive, and also in recovered OCD. So there is, at present, we have definite evidence to suggest that the cognitive deficits are trait markers with a worsening during the state. That is, if somebody already has deficit even during euthymia, I mean, they develop a manic or a depressive phase, the already existing cognitive deficits may further worsen. I guess
okay.
Answers the question.
Coming to the next question by Manu Rakesh, he wants to put in, I quote his question, that how age-related cognitive deficits can be enhanced in the background of shrinking gray matter and white matter volume in an aging brain?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. And I guess Dr. Pinto can answer that better than me because it is with the age-related cognitive decline. I will try and make an attempt. So with age, what has been seen is that there are certain cognitive functions which go down, but there are also other cognitive domains which actually become better. So in terms of structural brain changes, if I have to say, so you see from a posterior to anterior shift as we age. So in other words, instead of taking from a bottom-up approach of attention and concentration as your core, you start anticipation and planning as your core strength. So aged individuals are shown to anticipate the problem much better so that they bring their prayers, that is their previous experience, into the picture, and then they may be able to account for the same kind of a function, even though the processing speed or the motor functions or the attention and concentration decrease with age. So at present, several molecules have been tried to halt the progression of age-related cognitive decline or enhance, but unfortunately, none of them are, to my knowledge, have shown to be useful for age-related cognitive decline. Non-pharmacological strategies like learning a second language, playing a video game, having good social interactions, avoiding dementia, cutting down metabolic risk factors, decreasing endocrine risk factors like diabetes, keeping a good cardiovascular health, improving the exercise regime. These are all some of the strategies which one can employ to improve or avoid the age-related cognitive decline. So at present, I would suggest to go for a non-pharmacological strategy rather than for a pharmacological strategy, provided all parameters are normal. If somebody has vitamin deficiency or any subclinical undetected medical problems, addressing them is definitely required.
So we are at sea with the pharmacological options. So thank you, sir. The third question is by Shweta Seth. Is there any preventive strategies for people with risk of developing mental illnesses and subsequent risk of cognitive deficits associated with the illness? So like in early illness model, early stages model.
Excellent question. So when we say that the cognitive deficits are trait markers, why don't we treat it much earlier, like in the prodrome phase itself? So people have tried and tested the regular treatments, like olanzapine was tried, risperidone was tried in prodrome of schizophrenia. We don't have much studies in prodrome of bipolar. But the regular antipsychotics are not shown to be very beneficial in the treatment of prodrome of schizophrenia. So one molecule which is shown to be useful is the omega-3 fatty acid. But if we can give it at a very high dose of around 1,200 to 1,500 mg of the omega-3 fatty acid, that has shown to have a beneficial effect in terms of prevention of development of the illness and hopefully also in preventing further cognitive decline. Whether it will reverse the already existing trait marker, that's a big question which is yet to be examined, but it is definitely shown to be a protective agent for development of the illness and further cognitive decline.
Thanks, Dr. Narin. I'll combine two questions, Dr. Narin. They are pharmacological based questions. That is role of cerebroprotein, L-carnosin, and acetylcysteine in cognitive deficits. Also, the person has the audience has added mirtazapine and levomilnacitran. Does they have a role? So that is a question.
Yeah. So mirtazapine and levomilnacitran, I can answer it straight away because those two have been examined in randomized control trials, and the effect sizes are very small. That it is around 0.1 to 0.2. So mirtazapine and milnacipran don't have added advantage, which is clinically meaningful. Yes, they were better than placebo, but how much it translates to a clinical benefit is a question. The one side effect with mirtazapine, when you give it at a higher dose, is the sedation. And when people are drowsy and sedated, it can actually decrease their processing speed and the concentration, and it can actually confound the rest of the cognitive functions. So that is something that one need to remember trying to prescribe that. When it comes to other molecules, a plethora of molecules have actually been tried, starting from the L-carnosine or the N-acetylcysteine, the cerebroproteins, and also many of the neurosuticals like paracetam and other molecules. Unfortunately, they have not been shown to be beneficial with the available RCTs. And at the same time, the number of RCTs which have examined this are less. So the evidence base is less, but at the same time, it is commonly prescribed, may work in some, but may not work in many. So it's a dicey situation if you go with the evidence base for these molecules.
So very well answered, Dr. Narin. The next question actually stretches our boundaries of neuroscience. We all are students of neuroscience, but I think I'll put it up across to you, but Dr. Ramesh Babu, that while dealing with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis with cognitive deficit, what is the latest evidence-based treatment modality, specifically in our context?
Okay. It's a primary neurological illness. Yes. One interesting thing is People have reported riluzole, maybe one molecule which may still hold some promise for these patients. When it decreases the symptoms, it can also result in improvement. But frankly, I haven't seen literature related to amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. Yeah. So riluzole is primarily based on the theoretical implication of working on the glutamatergic, and the primary pathology in ALS is also the same. So there was some initial interest, but I'm not up to date with the current literature.
So, well, Dr. Ramesh, we will get back to you on this. Thanks for the question. Dr. Ruhi Satija wants to ask specifically, sir, that cognitive impairment, they vary over course of time. And what specific impact do these impairments have in terms of implications in treatment modality?
Okay, yeah. So it's an excellent question. Like I was telling, there is something like a trait marker which is present. But over the course, you will also see a waxing and waning of the cognitive deficit. Okay. Sometimes it is associated with the symptoms, that is, with mania or depression, you may see more deficit. But at the same time, you also see another kind of worsening with the progression of the illness. So in the initial phase of the illness, the focus will be to achieve a symptom remission and to put the person out of danger to self and others. But once you achieve symptom remission and decrease the distress, and when you want to put the person back to the community, that is the functional recovery, that is when the cognitive deficits will come to the picture. So the treatment implication of cognitive deficit is going to be, if you want to reintegrate the person into the community and try to achieve more than just the symptom remission. And in specific set of patients who actually have considerable cognitive demand, some of the case scenarios which I had put were that, for example, if you have an architect who want to be more creative, and this person is having a lot of problem with the sleep and drowsiness and cannot do. So this is one example. The other example is somebody who is a MBBS graduate, so he need to remember a lot of drugs and is not able to do that. Or it may be sometimes even a regular job like a bank employee, because this person has to count money and has to keep track of how much money was given in a day-to-day basis and finds it very difficult to concentrate and do that. So that's another example. Or sometimes we do come across, if we ask and carefully look, even in some of the tasks which we think are very easy, like a school teacher, because the school teacher has to address like 30 patients and keep track of what is happening with each of those kids who are full of energy. So the person requires a lot of cognitive functions and multitasking if parallelly you need to address these things. So the treatment implication could be present in multiple patients at different timeline, but it's primarily, if you want to reintegrate somebody into the society, you definitely need addressing the cognitive dysfunction.
Thank you, sir. Akansha wants to put up an interesting question, that computer administrative cognitive tests, when we compare those to cognitive structured cognitive assessments which we do into our, in a clinic and research, so do they have any differences in reliability? And then, sir, how, as they are being used in high screening in high risk jobs like aerospace industry, so whether they are reliable and valid enough?
Okay. So more than schizophrenia and bipolar, the computer administered tasks have come in a big way in dementia literature. For example, the Cogstate, which I mentioned, can be completely administered using a computerized and online platform. So they are as reliable, and sometimes they also give much better information compared to the therapist administered. But where they fail is getting the qualitative information. So this is similar to the problem of doing a clinical interview versus administering a scale like PANSS. So you miss out a lot of clinical information when you actually stick to a structured scale or a structured assessment, which the clinician otherwise can gauge. So in the similar way, if you are looking for only specific parameters, computerized tests are as good as the manually administered. But at the same time, manually administered can give much greater information compared to the therapist, compared to the computer administered. So when it comes to high risk jobs, because the numbers are small, it may be like a therapist is administering and the task is what is commonly used. But if you want to measure something which is very sensitive, like reaction time, then the computer administered task is better. So what is commonly practiced whenever in the research setting is that in these instances, instead of leaving it completely to the computer, a therapist may administer a computerized task so that you note down the responses using the computer, but the instructions and the observations are done by a therapist. A hybrid method is always better.
It's a very interesting question by the audience. Dr. Jyoti, she wants to put up that what is the role of neuroplasticity in cognitive deficits and any differences found in trans-diagnostic manner like schizophrenia, bipolar, depression, OCD?
Sure. Yeah, again, very interesting question. It's difficult because all these disorders, if you conceptualize them as discrete, then you may be looking them at separately. On the other hand, if you look at all these disorders as neurodevelopmental, then there is some common pathology which is underlying this. And some of the neurobiology of cognitive deficits may also be similar across diagnosis. It need not be exactly the same, but at least there could be definite overlaps. So neuroplasticity, whether that would, that is something that can be utilized, it needs to be addressed in systematic studies because some antidepressants like Stablan was earlier considered to be a drug which may promote neuroplasticity and prevent further worsening or relapses in depression. But later it didn't kick off in the same way. So people also suggest that maybe aerobic exercise and yoga and other lifestyle changes and antioxidants especially may primarily work on the neuroplasticity. So at present, I don't have definitive answer, but it is definitely an interesting field to watch for. You may get one molecule which may work across diagnosis.
Right, sir. Thanks for the answer, sir. A very clinical scenario is put by Dr. Ashish Bhandari that when people with higher intelligence with cognitive deficit, they show a higher score like 24 or more in MMSE. So he says then how to screen such patients and how valid then MMSE becomes.
Yeah. So very, very pertinent question. Like I was mentioning the role of anti-dementia drugs in schizophrenia. So MMSE is not a very good tool to use because you have something like a roof effect. Okay. So everybody can score very high in MMSE even with a lower cognitive reserve. So when you see somebody is having very high pre-morbid cognitive function, if you administer MMSE to them, they may easily reach something which is above 24 or 25. Doesn't mean that they don't have cognitive deficits. It's just that the tool is not sensitive enough. So it is primarily a screening tool in for cognitive dysfunction, but one need to use very structured assessment and a little more intensive assessment if you need to assess in high functioning individuals. So sometimes it may be a good idea to ask some clinical questions rather than just addressing MMSE. I would prefer just asking the patients during the clinical interview, and then if required, do a intensive and structured assessment rather than relying on MMSE for screening the cognitive deficits.
Thank you, Dr. Narin. I think that would have answered Dr. Ashish Bhandari's question amicably. Dr. Sujita, she wants to actually, sir, put you into a fix as per your presentation, that you mentioned that low-dose antipsychotics are beneficial to reduce cognitive deficits in schizophrenia, but most cognitive deficits in schizophrenia have an intertwined psychological correlate. So when we reduce antipsychotic dose, how to manage if there is a worsening of psychotic symptoms? So how to attain the balance?
Yeah. So instead of directly decreasing, one definitely has to taper the dose. The available evidence from the RCTs suggest that if you don't go below the minimal effective dose, so for example, 4 mg of risperidone or 10 mg of olanzapine or 300 to 400 mg of quetiapine. Okay. So the minimum effective dose is 10 mg olanzapine equivalent if you consider. If you don't go below that, then the worsening of psychosis is less likely. So if you go below the minimum effective dose, then definitely you carry the risk of psychosis. So the balance is don't decrease it too much. At the same time, don't keep it at the same level that one required in the acute phase of the treatment.
Thank you. And for the one question, interesting question which has come up is the role of melatonin. We know that it is coming up in neurodegeneration, but the... Dr. Swapnil Yadav wants to ask that what is this role in psychiatric disorders in cognitive decline? The role of melatonin.
Role of melatonin. Yeah. So again, this is one molecule which has been tried for multiple indications. As an antidepressant was one of the thing. So some of the molecules which may actually work very well in healthy individuals may not work in the same way in patient population. Oxytocin is a very good example for that. It showed promising results in healthy individuals, whereas it wasn't very good in patient population. So until we test it in a RCT, we can't definitively say that it works based on basic science literature or the work in the healthy individual. So I think we need to wait and watch for melatonin's role in the psychiatric disorders. Definitely people have been trying that in depression as well as in bipolar disorder. Some studies have tried to look both melatonin and agomelatin in schizophrenia. Okay, but I don't think we have any study which has looked primarily cognitive function as an outcome measure.
Coming to last few questions. So one of the questions by my senior, Dr. Ruma Bhattacharya, is that we have talked about cognition as an epiphenomena, presumed to be an epiphenomena with depression. She wants to specifically put a question that if cognitive issues persist in after post-depression, so which is the best drug to tackle, sir? Drug of choice, as per you.
Drug of choice in depression with cognitive deficit.
So maybe depression remits and then subsequently patient is still having cognitive deficit. So what to prefer, sir?
At present, if you need a maintenance treatment, vortioxetin is definitely the first choice. Because that is one molecule which has shown to be having an edge over rest of the molecules. If you have reached remission with some other molecule and don't want to change that molecule, then maybe an add-on treatment is something that could be tried. A stimulant, because that is something which has been tested in few studies, not a great evidence base, but at the same time, there is no major risk. Okay. So first choice is vortioxetine or the duloxetine. First vortioxetine and then the duloxetine. But then if you don't want to change the rest of the antidepressant, add-on molecule is better. In postmenopausal women per se, raloxifene may have a added advantage because it's a phytoestrogen and may also help in cognition as well as decreasing some of the physical problems.
Okay, right, sir. Dr. Bhavesh Lakkadwala, sir has put up a lengthy question. I'll brief it up. He wants to specifically ask that if patients were bipolar, we know that in different phases, we use different treatment strategies. So in maintenance phase, if the cognitive deficits persist, or they come up de novo. So what should be the accurate strategies as per you?
So if there is a possibility, maybe I would switch over to lamotrigine from other anticonvulsants. if clinically it is feasible to switch the mood stabilizer. Among the antipsychotics, definitely lurasidone has an edge over rest of the molecules. So maybe if it is only for the maintenance phase and patient is not agitated, because both these molecules are not very good at controlling the agitation. So if it is for the maintenance phase with cognitive deficits are the primary concerns, if feasible, then I would change the molecules to this. If it is not feasible, then we will have to go for an experimental management. If affordability and resources are available, like with Dr. Laktawala, I'm sure in Mumbai you will have the resources. Cognitive retraining is definitely the next choice. If we, it definitely will be the first choice. In addition, if feasible, change the medication. That's what I would think of.
Next question, you all know that the Rietzberg had given subjective cognitive impairment concept. So I will quote the next question in the context of subjective versus objective cognitive deficit, like in major depressive disorder, it can be associated with pseudodementia. In such cases, is there any necessity to treat prophylactically, considering the fact that depression can itself lead to true cognitive deficits, especially in elderly?
Again, we have the expert, Dr. Pinto. Maybe sir can throw more light on that. The concept of pseudo-dementia itself is very questionable, because many people have later realized that if you longitudinally follow up these patients, many of them actually develop dementia at a later stage. So though there is a subjective deficit, if it is not picked up objectively, I think the first question I will ask is whether the tool that I am using is sensitive enough to pick up these minor subjective deficits. Like I mentioned, if I use MMSE in a doctor who can't remember 100 drugs, he may not show up any deficit in the tool of MMSE, but at the same time, he clearly says that I'm not as sharp as I was before, or I can't remember all the trade names that I'm supposed to remember. So I think the subjective component many times is associated with objective deficit if we use a proper tool. The trait level marker which is present may sometimes be worsened with the subjective component. So this we call something like a metacognition. So for example, how much confident I am in my own memory may get influenced in depression. So like the meta memory, like I may tell that I can't remember these things, but when I ask, I may be able to tell. So there is some amount of overlay, but it's not that if there is a subjective component, there is no objective deficit. So they both go together. Maybe there is an overlay with the subjective component.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So coming to the last question of the session, is pharmacological based question that aripiprazole has not been mentioned. Any study to show its efficacy in cognitive improvement in schizophrenia?
Yeah, I looked into the literature actually. Unfortunately, it has not been tested as a primary outcome measure and has not been included in any of the meta-analysis. So like I mentioned, it's not that absence of evidence is evidence to the contrary. It may still be much better compared to the other molecules, but at present we don't have the evidence for that. So I looked specifically for amisulpride and aripiprazole, but unfortunately we don't have good RCTs with that.
Thank you, Dr. Naren. It's wonderful to listen to you and subsequently answer those questions with impeccable accuracy. So I think we are done with the questions we had. I would like to apologize if some questions have been left out, because I have selected those as per the discussion. Over to the chairperson, sir.
Thank you.
So thank you, Dr. Naren, for your presentation and also answering the questions. A few things you mentioned that you asked me to answer, basically. I think so one of the tests that I use very often for assessing cognition is the ACE, Allen-Brooks cognitive evaluation. It can give better levels of impairment than the MMSE and the other tests, basically. So I use that. And depression usually is a forerunner of dementia, basically. But you have to treat the depression vigorously, no doubt about it, to see how much is dementia and how much is depression. Usually depression, if it is only depression, it will remit. But if it is underlying dementia, even bipolar later on when it comes, if a manic episode comes, then obviously it will remain as dementia. Any psychiatric symptom that comes after age of 65 or so is a forerunner for dementia later on with cognitive problems. Obviously, we have to be careful. And then, of course, we can the dementia gets exposed, basically. There's no doubt about it. The third thing is, I think ECT is a neurogenetic in the sense that it is neuroplastic. And ECTs can be used even in the elderly for depression or for any symptoms. And I don't think there's any problem in using ECTs. I don't know about TCDS, whether transcranial deep stimulation is another way of possibly handling cognition problems, more or less, in various disorders. I know you would be better to comment on that. Another thing is that I think long-acting one has to be very, very usefully used in schizophrenia, because the lesser number of relapses that we have, lesser number of problems on the brain that occurs usually. So a relapse to be prevented will be better with a long-acting antipsychotic drug, basically. These are a few remarks from myself. If Sanjay has some remarks, he can make.
No, I think it's very interesting. Excellent lecture. And it's very interesting what you mentioned about a lot of anecdotal evidence. And I like that statement of yours. And I agree. I hold the same principle that evidence, not having the evidence, does not mean evidence to the contrary. I recall we haven't done RCTs, but I recall a lot of clinical efficacy with a lot of drugs which do not have RCT based evidence. So we have to look at this, and cognition, like you mentioned about the MMSE and the tools, it's a lot of the cognition is not just localized to the people going to the office. India has a lot of farmers, and we find it's very, very difficult to, though we have Hindi-based tests, but we find that there is room for many more tools to adequately pick up, because those people who are executive or having a good deal of executive functioning, they're able to pick up their deficits very soon. And they come to us and they say, well, I'm missing something, you know, and I'm forgetting something. But those people who are not very cognitively into the work, the routine works, for them, it's very difficult, and they come to us in a very, very late stage. So we need to pick that up also. And along with not only the dementia, the cognitive deficits in everyone should be a focus, which is, I think, what Dr. Naren Rao has very adequately explained. But he's also explained that there is a whole lot of room to build on that. We need fantastic molecules, and we need much more research into that. So I think we had excellent questions also. And I think, Dr. Charles, we can go into the best question. I think people are waiting for us.
We have to go into a huddle.
I think the way to do it is to think out loud, you know, and
okay.
So in your mind, what is out of your thinking out loud, what strikes you as the best question? Most interesting.
I'll ask you.
I'm asking you.
I asked first.
I think the question of cognitive evaluation and cognition impairment, to detect it early and to detect it, to catch it early and to treat it effectively, was a question that was asked by somebody who was very good, I think so.
I think you're talking about the preventive concept. Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
Dr. Shobhit, who asked that question?
Yes, sir. Give me a second, sir. Sir, Shweta Seth.
Okay. What is the question? Please say it again.
Yeah. Sir, I'll quote the question. Are there any preventive strategies for people who are higher risk of developing mental illnesses and therefore the cognitive deficits associated with the illnesses, and for those people in early stages of an established mental illness?
Okay. So I think that was, what do you think?
Number Sanjay? One. Yeah. I agree. That struck me. Okay. As being very relevant, very, in fact, all the questions, I've got to say, all the questions were very, very good. And all the questions, they evoked a lot of interest and they were very relevant. But I think if you have to choose one, it's always, it's always a decision that, all the questions are good, but maybe this would be the best one. I agree.
Yeah. Takes the cake. Or takes the prize, sorry.
So I think Dr. Shweta Seth, I think we can safely say that the best question e-voucher, the Amazon e-voucher goes to Dr. Shweta Seth. So I think Dr. Shobhit announced that.
You can announce that, yeah.
Okay, so congratulations to Dr. Shweta Seth for winning this voucher and for the wonderful question, thought-provoking question you have put up. Congratulations, Dr. Shweta. Thank you.
I would like to thank you all, respected doctors, and thanks the participants for joining us today, and we hope to see you again on coming Tuesday, the 26th of January, at the same time from 8 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. as usual. Please block your date. The topic for the upcoming webinar is evidence-based management of ASD by Dr. Satya Raj. Based on all requests, all previous webinar archives are available on our YouTube channel, the MediSquire Global Education Resources channel. For any feedback and comments and queries, if you have them, please do email them to info@medisquire.com. Till then, stay safe and have a good night, everyone. Thank you so much, doctors. Good night.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Sanjay. Thank you, Shobhit.
Thank you. Thank you,
Jaya. Thank you, Narendra.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Banai. Thank you, Vino.
Thank you, Banai.
Thank you. Thank you,
Shobhit. Pleasure interacting. Thank you, sir. Good night, sir.
Good night.
Yeah, we'll have positive sleep, sir.
Lovely. All the best. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.